Good evening, friends. My name is Dr. Ghazala Shaikh. There is an old saying, with great power comes great responsibility. And doctors have been placed next only to God Himself, have great responsibility towards the society at large. It is very unfortunate to see that where are we heading. Today we read and hear about a lot of cases of infamous conduct and medical negligence committed by the doctors. Who is to be blamed for this? Rapid changes in the medical field or corporatization of the healthcare system? I think it is the high time to call for an introspection of the medical professionals. And today my talk is a humble reminder to the medical fraternity regarding the legal, ethical and moral duties of the medical professionals. Doctors have been placed at a very higher stature in the society, higher status in the society because of their wisdom, because of their knowledge and because of the nobility the profession demands. But nowadays, because of the corporatization, because of the change in the healthcare system, there are a lot of new cases are emerging where it is not, I can't label that that instances as medical negligence, but I have I realized that there is a strong need to create awareness among the people regarding the duties and rights of a doctor. It is very essential for the doctor-patient relationship. Nowadays, the doctor-patient relationship has been severed and the public is losing faith in medical fraternity. It's quite sad to see this because it is not it's not in the interest of the patient as well as the medical fraternity. So let's start. There are numerous duties of the medical professionals which are enshrined in the Hippocratic Oath, which is to be taken by the medical professionals before starting their career. Then there are International Code of Medical Ethics, and in my talk I have been referred to the Indian Medical Council Regulations 2002. So let's see, let's start. Let's start by the very famous prayer of eminent radiologist Robert Hutchison's prayers for the doctor, that states, from too much zeal for the new and contempt for the old, from putting knowledge before wisdom, science before art, cleverness before common sense, from treating patients as cases, and from making cure of disease more grievous than endurance thereof, God, good Lord, please deliver us. The first thing in the code of medical ethics is about character of the physician. The first duty of the medical professional is to uphold the dignity and honor of the profession. The prime object should always be to render service to humanity, and to do this he should keep himself in pure in character and be diligent. Be sober, modest, patient, and prompt in discharging his duties towards his patient without anxiety, and conduct himself with propriety in his profession. The second thing is about maintaining good medical practice. For this, the physician should merit the confidence of patients entrusted to their care. Physician should try continuously to improve their medical knowledge and skill. He should practice methods of healing founded on scientific basis and should not associate professionally with anyone who violates this principle. Now this, especially the last paragraph, which is stating about healing based on scientific evidence. There are many alternative medicines nowadays which has been incorporated in the conventional medicine as well, like such as yoga. Yoga has been proved on the scientific basis really helpful for maintaining their health, and that's why many allopaths are also referring their patients for meditation and alternative healings. But there are, at the same time, there are many exaggerated claims regarding the alternative medicines. So these all duties are basically for the allopaths. It's not covered by the other paramedical, or you can say the alternative medicine professional. This is basically for the convention and Western medicine, which allopathic doctors, these all duties are assigned to them. So while referring, they should always see to it that the healer they are referring, they should be practicing a pathy which has some scientific evidence to it. It's very important. Membership in medical society. For the advancement of his profession, the doctor should affiliate with association and societies. He should participate in professional meeting as part of CME, that is continuing medical education, because there is rapid changes in the medical science every few years. So he must update his knowledge and at least attend 30 hours every 5 hours or 5 years organized by reputed professional academic bodies or any other authorized organization like MCI. Maintenance of medical records. Every physician shall maintain the medical records pertaining to indoor patients for period of 3 years from the date of commencement of the treatment in a standard pro forma which is laid down by the Medical Council of India. If any request is made for the medical records, either by the patient or the authorized attendant or the legal authorities involved, the same may be duly acknowledged and issued within a period of 72 hours. This is very important because for the case of medical negligence, you must have the entire set of your medical records. And there are many cases which I attain in my NGO where the patients or relatives come, where they have been denied the medical record. So this is totally in violation with the duties laid down by the MCI. If you request for your medical, a copy of, and the copy should be duly signed and stamped by the hospital authorities to make it legally valid, and it should be numbered. So when you are filing the case in any forum or commission, there should not be any doubt regarding the authenticity of that medical records.
This one in the hospital, or even we go to the family doctor also. Mm-hmm. So that doctor is also supposed to keep the record?
Yeah, they have the, if you are going to a family physician, yeah, they must have any record of your your daily prescription. So they must keep a copy of that with them.
You
also
should also keep it for 3 years.
In case, yeah, it's recommended for them, especially the medical, not the all prescriptions, but in case of like you are attending an emergency case or you have gone for a home visit, in that time you should record all the, condition of the patient while attending.
But I think these doctors
are... No, the GPs generally don't keep, but yeah, there is a strong guideline regarding maintaining the medical medical certificates. There must be a registered which is maintained by the physician, or regarding all the medical certificate he has issued, because this has a lot of legal significance. I was coming to that. A physician shall maintain a register of medical certificate giving full details of the certificate issues, like fitness certificate or any kind of illness or when issuing a medical certificate, he shall always enter the identification mark of the patient and keep a copy of that certificate. He shall not omit to record the signature and thumb mark, address, and at least one identification mark of the patient on the medical certificate. As I was saying, that it has having a lot of legal significance, because the medical certificate, they have to come to the court and testify if you issue a medical certificate and it is without these requirements, like if you, it has not mentioned, sometime even in absentia people obtain the medical certificate for their relatives. This is very, very dangerous for the medical practitioners. You have to obtain the signature and ID mark of your patient. Any of the, that becomes very important.
Now we are sick in the office and we require certificates, so they give.
But in case, in, you know, if any untoward or any exceptional circumstances, some people may commit an offense during that time and he may obtain a certificate. So that become, you never know when it can become a, you know, trouble for the doctor. So it's very important to obtain the ID proof of the patient and a signature on the medical certificate, and keep a copy of that same certificate with himself also. So in case if somebody misuse that medical certificate, he can come up with his own version, because it has been misused. There are many doctors who have been wrongly caught because of issuing certificate without attending the patient. Display of registration number. Every physician shall display the registration number accorded by the medical council in his clinic, in all his prescription, in receipt and certificates as well. And you can even trace whether your doctor is really or it's not a fake degree. You can always go for the, you can check online the registration number. It is there, the list of the medical council, the doctor who have been registered with the council are there. So if you have any doubt regarding the qualification of the doctor, you can always confirm by the registration number. Use of generic name of drugs. This is again a very it's a issue, debate kind of things. Every physician should, as far as possible, prescribe drugs with generic names and ensure that there is rational prescription and use of drug. Now, in Islam areas where many non-allopath doctors are practicing allopathy medicine, there is irrational use of antibiotics is seen. So it should be stopped, but again, we don't have any code of ethics which can, you know, regulate this. Highest quality assurance in patient care. It's also important for the physician to safeguard against admission to it those who are deficient in moral character or education. The staff or doctor uses in his clinic or hospital, they must be registered with the nursing council if nurses are there, or if some RMOs are working from non-allopathic degrees, they must be also be registered practitioners. The many quacks or many people who are not qualified as nurses are also working as a nurses in small nursing home. That is always, that's also a danger regarding the patient care. So a doctor has to take care of his subordinates, their knowledge and their skills as well. Exposure of, yeah, if you see in small nursing home, you can't ensure that the nurses who are working there are properly registered nurses. Yes, exposure, as I said, in today's healthcare system, there is lot of privatization, and all the people cannot afford the corporate hospital. In corporate hospital, you will see all the standards have been followed as far as the qualification and skills of the nurses and doctors are concerned. But in small nursing home, you know, in suburb area, there is no regulatory bodies to, you know, incur these kind of practices. It can, if the public is aware of their rights and they also know a little bit about the duties of the doctor, then they can question the doctor. In India, basically, the doctor, the medical fraternity is not being questioned. But nowadays, the trend is changing. There are many instances where doctors are even wrongly, you know, implicated in the cases of medical negligence, where it is not medical negligence, but it's a misadventure, you can say. But because of the distrust between the patient and the doctor, we are now witnessing increase in number of complaints coming from the patients for the doctors.
Yeah, a few days back the paper has come, there are many doctors who are fake doctors.
Yeah, there are. That's why if every patient knows that I have a right to inquire about the registration number, the doctor's prescription should state his registration number, then he can always verify it with the council, and he can come up that if the doctor is a fake doctor or a quack, and then the action can be appropriate, legal authorities can take action on that quack. Yes, yes. No. In India, people are not aware of their rights as patient, because nowadays medical profession is also a service. So your doctor become a service provider and the patient has become a consumer. So that's why they have rights. But again, you should not, you should always keep in mind that the doctors also have certain rights as you as a patient has rights, and though both there should be a very healthy and clear kind of relationship between the doctor and the patients. Payment of the professional services. This is one thing which is again very important, that the physician's primary concern should not be the financial interest, but the benefit, the health of the patient. And the doctor has to announce his fees before rendering his services. Many times what happened, the doctor give an estimate which is far less than the actual bill a patient has to pay at the time of discharge.
Yeah.
So maximum dispute arises at the time of discharge in small nursing home. This is because the doctors are not following their duty, that they have a duty to announce the patient their water charges they are going to take from the patient before starting the treatment. Remuneration received for such services should be in the form and amount specifically announced to the patient at the time the service is rendered. Many people come to the NGO regarding the inflated hospital bills, but you can't help it, because corporate hospital, they give you everything at the time of admission also, that these are the charges and you will be charged like this. But then again, in small nursing home, or this rule is not followed, so there is again chances of dispute between the patient and doctors. Yes. Now, western suburb, basically there are the people are more, and the medical skill professional. Yeah, any crowded place you will see a lot of these things are happening here. No, there are guidelines which has to be followed, but in India there are lots of acts, but nobody acts on those acts. That's the problem. The second part is about the duties of a doctor towards his patient. All the previous duty I was talking about, it was regarding the medical professional, how he has to be a good doctor, like maintaining the medical records, maintaining good medical practice, now the second part, which is I think the main bulk and the most important part of the duties of a doctor, which is towards his patients. The main ethical principle to guide the medical fraternity in treating the patient are, number one, autonomy, second is beneficence, third is non-malfeasance, and fourth is compassion. These four principles, I will explain. Autonomy, the patient's right to self-determination. The patient should have a right to choose. He should have an equal participation in the medical decision making. Whenever you go to the doctor and you present your own complaints, the doctor, examine you, he obtain the sign, and then there are differential diagnoses, a number of tests is prescribed. You should know what are these tests are for and how much is going to cost, and at the time of when the report has come, and the final, there are two stages in a treatment. The first one, which is most important, is diagnosis, which is when you go for the first consultation, you have been prescribed a number of tests that is based on the sign which a doctor made while examining you. The patient comes with symptoms, the doctor is the one who you know, examine and take out the signs from that, and he to confirm the diagnosis he need the lab and pathology investigation. So he prescribed a number of tests. This is one part of the treatment, that is diagnosis, and it has to be, you know, it should not always be accurate, but it should be proper. It should be, you know, all the differential diagnosis should be made judicially, and the test nowadays, again, it is difficult for the medical professionals, because sometimes if they you know, they go for a long list of diagnosis, then also it becomes difficult for the patients. So there are two methods. Either you have to, a doctor nowadays has become, you know, very cautious of getting implicated in fear of, you know, getting into the legal hurdles. So that's why, to safeguard themselves, they prescribe a lot of diagnostic tests. It is for, because nowadays people may come up with these kind of issues as well, that why you have not you know, described this test. Sometime it happens because human error. The doctors are also not God, they are also human beings. So it's they even being very cautious, they may sometime miss. So medical error in medical judgment is not medical negligence. Negligence is a big word where there is a breach of the duty to take care, which I will explain later. I was describing autonomy. Autonomy of the patient is the patient's right to choose. He has to equally participate in the medical decision making. Aapka ek diagnosis ka part mein describe kar rahi thi. When that is over, now you have been suffering from XYZ disease. Now when you come to with the reports, the doctor made the accurate, the proper diagnosis, and then the start of the treatment is there. So now you always have A, B, C options in the treatment. You have the medical treatment, you may have the surgical treatment for that as well. But the doctor has to disclose you all the available treatment and the facilities where they are available. But he has to give you an option of A, B, C, and the patient has to choose between A, B, C as per his own, you know, preferences, his own economic condition. He has a right to choose among all. That is called autonomy. And the second concept is of informed consent. These are the words of the famous Justice Cardozo regarding the patient's right to self-determination. Every human being of adult years and sound mind has a right to decide what shall be done with his own body, and the surgeon who performs an operation without his patient's consent commits an assault which is for which he is liable. That means consent is something which is very, very important in doctor-patient relationship, and it has to be informed consent. Like before the start of the treatment, you should understand what the disease you are suffering from, what are the different choices or alternatives available to you, all pros and cons of each and every alternative. And all these information has to be provided by the treating physician. It is his duty bound to give you all information regarding your illness, regarding the choices of the treatment, regarding pros and cons, regarding the various factors which are related with negative outcome. Sometimes it happens, you may heard of, you know, many instances when a very good doctor, very good hospital may come up with the, you know, negative outcome, or the treatment is not successful. It's not because of the deficiency on the part of the care provided by the medical professional, but there are many factors which are responsible towards the prognosis of that particular patient. See, in medical science is not an exact science, you know. In there is always 1-2% chances. Even if you will go to a lab and if you will read about sensitivity of any of the lab test or pathology test, you will always see there is 99.9% chances. There is 0.1% chance of, you know, getting a wrong result. So you should always keep in mind that all the negative outcomes of a treatment is not medical negligence. You have to study a lot, you have to understand, because every human body is unique. So how it is going to respond to a treatment is quite unpredictable, even for a very experienced and skilled doctor. Now we will come, what is informed consent? Informed consent is a very crucial part of the doctor-patient relationship. All the cases of medical negligence or the, you can say, medical misadventures or the medical dispute, consumer dispute related with medical professionals are basically due to, you know, difficulty in this part. Because of the improper, inadequate description or the communication between the doctor and patient, there is distrust between the patient and his relative. It's very important for the doctors to always take care of the patients, and you know, because a lot of relatives are involved in the medical decision making. That also become a very, you know, problem situation. It's a problematic situation for the doctor, because he can't, he doesn't have that much time to explain to each and every relative. So the patients, it is there is something called patient's advocate. Any of your family members who is intelligent, who is aware, who is, you know, well educated, who has access to the internet, and who is aware of the rights of the doctors and duties of the right and duties of patient and doctor both, he has to be a speaker regarding the patient, and the doctor has to explain him, and then he can explain to all other relatives that what is the patient suffering from, what are the choices of treatment available to us, what are the pros and cons, what are, you know, positive and negative outcome or the complication related with each of these choices. And if first koi bhi decision ke liye, first you have to be supplied with information, and that information must be easy and comprehensible to the patient. You can't expect the patient to understand the same thing as a doctor has understand. But definitely to make a judgment, I should have a clear vision that what is happening within me, you know, what is what's wrong in my body, and that has to be, you know, accessible, has to be understood by the patient or the relatives. So the first thing is, the first element of the consent is disclosure of information. That information must be clear, comprehensible, and the doctor should try to explain it, not just to, you know, obtain the consent. Nowadays people just give you a paper that before the operation or before any of the procedure you go, they give you a paper, you have to read. This is the totally wrong method of obtaining the consent. There has to be, you know, proper, you have to sit with the patient, you have to read each and everything, you have to explain them. Then you must give them time to, you know, go through it. If they have any doubts, they can ask the doctor that time. And after that, it is basically an agreement. Consent is in legal, it is that both the mind, that of the doctor, of the patient, they are agreed to a thing, and that is regarding the medical decision making. And it can be equal. It's not to be that the doctor is saying and he is superior in knowledge, that means the patient has to do it. Nowadays nobody is going to, you know, accept this. Now there is equality in the medical decision making, and that is what is I was calling as autonomy of the patient, that is the right to self-determination. And for this to happen, a person has to be given clear information, he should understand it, and after going through, you know, all the available information, when he decide for something that is a valid medical decision, then it will be a valid thing, and then when he sign it, that consent become a proper informed consent. The doctor should not just tell you to sign a document which you don't understand, which you still have query regarding, you know, what the procedure is and how much time it will take, what are the complications which may occur after some time. You know, these all has to be very, very clear before obtaining the consent. And the doctor objective is not just to secure the consent, that the patient has to sign. No, they has to explain the patient regarding each and everything to clear his doubts, and then only the patient right to, you know, self-determination will be secured. And it is helpful for the patient, for the doctor, because if he has followed all these things, if then he is safe from you know, be accused of any kind of medical happening. The second is competence. Like I said, the patient should be able to understand that. Understanding, voluntariness, because if once you understand, then only you can say yes or no to it, and it should be your free choice. You should not be under any kind of influence from the doctor or any kind of caution from any of this. The patient has a full right to decide about his own body. Otherwise, it becomes an assault, because if somebody do anything to you for which you have not given your consent, then it is assault as per the legal definition. The last and the most important thing is principle of privacy and confidentiality. Yes, because the doctor, a patient shares many, sensitive and personal information with the doctor. So a doctor is duty bound to, keep those information very, very confidential and should not disclose until. There is always an exception to this. If there are, there is a very famous case of somebody's HIV status. If there is the principle of confidentiality on one hand versus right to life. Right to life is always above. If somebody is getting married to, HIV positive person, and that person's doctor discloses that no, the groom you are getting your daughter married is suffering from HIV. So in that case, the court has held that right to life is above the principle of confidentiality. Because if he keep this information confidential, then life of someone else is at threat. So that has to be a balancing between, the different rights. So in that case, there is only one exception when there is legal authorities, call you for disclosing some private information about that person, then you are duty bound to disclose before the legal authorities. And when there is public, when it's threat to someone's life, or there is public interest, something which is done in the public interest, then there is always exception to this right of privacy and confidentiality. Beneficence, a physician's primary duty is to relieve suffering, reduce pain, produce beneficial outcome, and enhance the quality of his patient's life. This and all of these things make the medical profession a noble profession. Non-malfeasance. A physician should always act in good faith. When you see the IPC, when you read IPC, the Indian Penal Code, regarding the clauses of negligence, criminal negligence, there is this term has a lot of significance. What is good faith? Good faith is anything, which you do for the patient in good faith, and if it's not done, it is done without due care or attention. If you do anything with care and attention, you have done it for the benefit of the patient. If this element, due care and attention, is not there, then you have not acted in good faith. So the patient's, the physician, the doctor's first duty is to take care, not cure. Cure is something which is not being guaranteed, but yeah, you can always take good care of your patient. And that care, what is demand for giving good care to my patient? I must have the requisite knowledge and skill. And if I followed the accepted norms and methods of treatment, then I have acted in good faith. And even if that, whatever I did to save the life of the patient, I may not be, successful all of the time, I have acted in good faith. This is a very strong defense for the medical professionals. Few years back, I think, when the many doctors were refusing the emergency patients because they have to go for a lot of paperwork, they have to inform the police. Nowadays, the law is very clear. The law say a doctor has nothing to do with the offense. The first, their prime objective is to save life, and they immediately start doing that. without, you know, waiting for the all the paper and administrative work.
Emergency.
Yes, yes. Because the person life is something which is very important than the legal procedures and all.
Yeah, before that,
and time is very essence. Yeah, in when you are working as a doctor, for you the time is very important to save. Where if you lose the time, you know, in all the work, yes, yeah. The last thing is compassion. Whenever dealing with patients, the physician is expected to be compassionate towards the patient. Now, for being compassionate, you should have empathy towards your patient. You should treat the patient as your own, you know, family members. And you should always take care of, you know, their respect, their culture, their food habits. He should never behave as though he is anyway superior or father figure to the patient. They must give equal right and respect to the patient. So, these are few duties of the medical professionals. There are many more duties which I will be discussing in my next talk. Thanks for being here.
Thanks for the beautiful lecture.
Thanks.